So in the last set of videos, we had constructed our basic five-stage pipeline, and we had discussed how to deal with hazards and data dependencies and all of these problems. Now we're going to try and extend that basic design to try and improve performance. Okay, and there are two basic approaches to try and improve performance. One can be regarded as the hardware-intensive solution, where I add a lot of intelligence and add these new circuits into my hardware to try and analyze a program and try to boost performance. The alternative is what I'll describe as the software-intensive approach, where I keep my hardware design roughly the same, and I instead rely on the compiler to try and schedule instructions to boost performance. Okay, so it is, you know, by now it is kind of clear that if I want to maximize performance, the hardware-intensive approach is clearly superior. Okay, it can do a much better job of understanding the program and trying to minimize stalls, but it has certain overheads. It consumes more power because those additional circuits do burn a lot more power. Because there are more circuits which are perhaps complex, it might also result in lower clock speed. And because of those complex circuits, it also takes longer to design and verify that new processor. Okay, instead, the compiler-based approach is attractive because it eliminates all of these problems. It keeps your processor design, you know, much simpler, and it is perhaps easier for the compiler to try and figure out the best way to hide stalls and long latencies. Okay, and you know, this, as I said, this is perhaps not the best way to maximize performance, but because it is superior on these counts, it is perhaps suited for the embedded domain or any other classes of processors where low energy is of utmost importance. Okay, so you know, this approach is very important because it is applicable to a very large class of processors. Okay, so we'll focus on that for this lecture and I think the next couple of lectures as well. So, you know, let's see what the goal of the compiler is. You know, I'll introduce this term instruction level parallelism at this point. Okay, what ILP refers to is how many instructions am I working on concurrently within my pipeline. Okay, so when I build a five-stage pipeline, I'm allowing five different instructions to be at different stages of completion within my processor, right? So that's an example of ILP. I could also extend the width of my pipeline, which is to say that I could fetch two instructions, I could decode two instructions, I could execute two instructions all at the same time. Okay, so a five-stage pipeline with a width of 2 is capable of executing 10 instructions at the same time. So that's an ILP of 10. Okay, anytime you have a stall cycle, that's when a stage is doing something that is not useful, right? So your ILP starts to drop in that case. Okay, so if I want to maximize my ILP, I have to make sure that I minimize my stall cycles, right? And what leads to stall cycles finally? It is dependencies within my program. Okay, so until now I'd been using the terms dependencies and hazards interchangeably, but there's a subtle difference, right? So dependence is a property of the program. So if the program is going to produce a result in R1 and then read it, that leads to a data dependence, and that's a property of the program. Your program has the certain data dependence within its chain of instructions. This dependence may or may not lead to a hazard depending on the nature of the pipeline, right? Some pipelines may have forwarding and bypassing, which means you don't have to introduce a stall. Okay, but there are other pipelines where, you know, this dependence may lead to stall cycles. Your decode stage might figure out that there is this dependence which is causing a hazard. I need to delay the consumer until the hazard is resolved. Okay, so for the rest of the discussion, I'm going to assume a given pipeline, okay, and likewise the program is going to have certain dependencies, but I'm going to try and reorder these instructions to minimize the occurrence of a hazard. That's our objective for this lecture and the next. Okay, so the compiler is trying to minimize stalls with intelligent scheduling. We are going to focus primarily on loops because, you know, many people have shown that for the kinds of programs that run on embedded devices, the execution time is dominated by loops. They account for most cycles, and loops are also easy to analyze and optimize. Okay, so that'll be your focus in this class. So what assumptions am I going to make before diving into these examples? So we're going to go back to this process that we discussed in an earlier video, right? And in this case, the load goes through this path over here, right? And it takes essentially, you know, two cycles worth of work where one cycle is spent calculating the address in this stage, and then one cycle is spent accessing the data memory in the second stage. And I'm going to assume that this processor has bypassing in it. Okay, so accordingly, if there's a consumer coming right behind the load, it's going to experience one stall cycle, right? So I'm just recapping what we had discussed earlier. I won't go into the detailed derivation of each of these numbers, just refer to our earlier discussion on this. A floating point ALU takes four cycles when it goes through this path over here, which means the consumer coming right behind it is going to experience a three-cycle stall. If the consumer is a store, then because the store needs its input in the second data memory stage, it experiences a shorter stall window. So it's going to have a two-cycle stall. Okay. I'm also going to assume one branch delay slot, which means the instruction after the branch will be fetched and executed. And if you're executing an integer ALU operation that goes through this path over here, there's only one cycle worth of work, which means the consumer coming right behind does not experience a stall. But if the consumer is a branch, and this is a case we had not discussed earlier, then it does experience one stall cycle, right? Because if you have an add followed by an add, I said there's no stall over here. The point of consumption is right here for the consumer. If I have an add followed by a branch, we had discussed before that a branch completes in two cycles, right? So the branch is going to finish at this point, which means this is its point of consumption. This is where it needs the value to be ready. Okay, and since that is earlier, this results in one stall cycle between the add and the branch. Okay, so this is just a quick recap summarized in this cloud right here, and I'll keep showing this cheat sheet cloud as we go through the next few examples. So here's our first example. This is the C source code I'm showing in the black lettering over here. What you're doing is going through an array, and you're essentially going from array element x1000 down to array element x1. Okay, and for each of those elements, I'm just going to increment the value by a given scalar, which in this case happens to be a floating point value. Okay, so it's a very simple loop written in C. That translates into this assembly code that I'm showing in blue. Okay, the first thing I do is I need to bring in array element xi into a register, in this case a floating point register, so it's called F0, so that's what is happening by this with this load. Okay, so register R1 has a pointer to the location of xi. Since I'm starting at x1000, I'm assuming that before I enter this loop, R1 has already been set to the address of x1000. Then I increment F0, which is the value I've just fetched, by F2, right? So beforehand again, so before getting into the loop, I have set R1 to point to x1000. I've also set F2 to be equal to the value of S, okay? And so after I do this increment and save the result in F4, I'm going to store the value in F4 back into the location for xi. Okay, once that is done, I now need to move on to the next iteration, right? So every iteration essentially has three instructions worth of work. It is loading the value from memory, doing the increment, and then storing it back, right? So it's basically three real pieces of work. Now I just need to get ready for the next iteration. So I need to change xi to xi minus 1, and I do that by just decrementing R1 by 8. Okay, so that's what is happening over here. R1 is being decremented by 8. Then I check to see if I've reached the end of the loop. So I'm comparing R1 to the address for x0. If R1 has reached the address of x0, then I've reached the end of the loop. Otherwise, I loop back and start again over here. So again, I've preloaded R2 to be the value to point to the address of x0. Right, so this stuff has been done before entering the loop. Okay, and now since my architecture has a branch delay slot, and since I'm constructing this naive assembly code, I'm also going to put a no-op over here, because the instruction after the branch is going to be fetched and executed. I'm doing nothing clever, I'm just putting in a no-op instruction. Okay, so the first question we need to answer is, I produced this this 5 or 6 instruction assembly code for my C source code. How long is this going to take to run on my example pipeline? Okay, so let's look at our cheat sheet and correspondingly introduce stalls. Okay, so I have a load, and the value of the load feeds into this consuming add. So load feeding any instruction, one stall cycle. That's what I've introduced here. then a floating point add which feeds into a store, right? I'm producing a value in F4 which is then being used by the store. So floating point add feeding a store two stall cycles. That's what I've introduced over here. Okay, then the store is followed by this decrement of R1. There's no dependence over here, so there's no stall cycle. Then an add feeding a branch, an integer add feeding a branch, is going to result in one stall cycle. Okay, and then I have a branch delay slot, so there's the no op that I execute over here, which is like a stall. I'm really not doing anything useful. Okay, so ultimately I had this 5-line assembly code, which is trying to do, you know, 3 instructions worth of work. Right? It's, you know, as I said, this is really the heart of the iteration. That's what I need to do xi equals xi plus s. So it's 3 instructions worth of work, which requires 5 assembly instructions, thanks to this decrement and this branch instruction. And these 5 assembly instructions goes on to take 10 cycles. Okay, so it's not a very efficient schedule, and this is what we're going to improve in the next video.